It is my pleasure to introduce my professor and friend, Dr. Hala Al-Wakil, the head of Nephrology and Transplantation Unit, Alexandria University. Her talk is about DASH diet in CKD. Should we embrace it?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Thank you very much, my dear friend Dr. Iman, for this kind introduction. Second, I would like to thank you again and the whole team, namely my professor, Professor Salah Naga and Muhammad Saeed, all the team who make a lot of effort to get these events and to meet again after the long period of this communication. This lecture also is dedicated for Professor, my dear Professor Amr Abid, Allah yirhamu, Rabbana inshallah yirhamu, yibba kull al-ilm illi khadna minnu yibba fi mizan hasanatu. This was a title that I was given by the committee, that what about DASH diet in CKD, should we embrace it or not? First, we have to know what is DASH diet. It is a dietary approach to stop hypertension, that's say to eat less salt. And the target was on two levels. They advocate to use low sodium, either at a level of 2.3 gram per day or 1.5 gram per day. Again, like Professor Hussein just mentioned, there is a difference between salt and sodium. So the global mean intake of salt all around the world, it is 10 gram of salt daily, and this is equivalent to 4 gram of sodium. This is our data from the EMRO office for of the WHO. We are among the population that consume a lot of sodium, approaching 4 grams, and this was measured by a statistical model of equations. But the golden standard to assess the sodium intake is the 24-hour urinary sodium excretion approach. And unfortunately, Egypt was not among the countries that that have its data as regards the 24-hour urine protein excretion. But again, all of the neighbor countries are above the recommended. This is an Alexandrian study based on the dietary assessment by the recall method. They are recalling what they are eating and calculating. This is not very accurate, but also, again, Egypt among the heavy user of salt. For that reason, the WHO initiated a global action plan that end this year, and they continue another plan for 2030. And among the recommendations and the global target to reduce the salt, the relative intake of salt to 30% of the used. The nutrient, the daily nutrient goals in the DASH studies include this amount of sodium, but they include also among the 2,000 calorie per day, 50% of carb, and around 20% of protein, and 27% of fats. And they recommend all these components, the grains, the vegetables, the fruits, the low-fat dairy products, the nuts, and all these. And they ask for some stepwise maneuvers or strategies so as to enhance the user for DASH, that you have to get a target, you have to have an accompanying person to encourage you to continue this DASH diet and so on. Where is the sodium in all these scenarios? The sodium is present in all of these, in different amounts, even in the vegetables, in the low-fat dairy components, all these contain sodium. And there are a lot of tips to reduce salt and sodium intake. We advise all, we give all these advice to our patients, but really it's difficult to convince, and if you try it, it is somewhat difficult, and these are the advices we are giving to our patients. Among these advices, you have to learn your patient what is the meaning of this and what is the impact of this sodium, not only on the hypertension he has, but also for the renal function. And simply, if he has this label, he has to read that sodium in that canned tomato, it's 100% among 10 milligram, and the other one is 6% among the 150 milligram. So this is not six times that one, but it is 15 times the other one in the sodium content. Again, this DASH, does it protect our kidney patients? Does it slow the progression of kidney disease? There are two main studies that it was involved in that issue. The first is that one, that they proved that DASH lower uric acid among CKD patients. And this was their data, their baseline data, and the neutron components of the DASH diet and the control diet, and they found that it did lower the uric acid level, and there are some astonishing data that I would like to share you. These data that first. The DASH diet was lower, the DASH group, I mean, has a lower uric acid in comparison to the control group when we compare the baseline. And this was evident especially with those who are taking low sodium and medium sodium, but that doesn't differ among those taking high sodium. And this was the graph that showed this, but also the statistics somewhat is deceiving. The DASH is a green light, the green line, so it decreases from the blue line, which is a control. But the significant difference was high among this group, among the low and the medium sodium intake. But it doesn't differ with this high sodium group. But this could be referred because the baseline of those patients are higher, the low and medium sodium. So we cannot take the statistical conclusion as if we, because this could be deceiving. The conclusion that it did lower the serum uric acid, and this is greater among the those who have a baseline high serum uric acid, and those taking higher sodium intake in comparison to the other group. The second study was the DASH. This study, it was a huge study. It comprised a large number of patients, I guess, 3,700 patients. But the modality of taking this data was just a questionnaire. They are completing a questionnaire for everything. So this is a weakness of this study. It is self-reported dietary intake. It's not a 24-hour protein, 24-hour sodium intake excretion. It is not 24 recall methods, just self-reporting method, and also they lack the data of albuminuria. The conclusion of this study was the DASH-style diet was associated with lower risk of kidney disease independent of demographic characteristics and established risk, kidney risk factor and baseline kidney function, and they recommend this to be used for our kidney patients for prevention of kidney disease. But there is a lot of debate about this, this complicated study, because as I told you, the modality was just an epidemiological study. They depend on the questionnaire. So diet is not a simple issue. It is like a Cinderella. It is a part of integrated approach for our advanced CKD. It's not just DASH is good, DASH is not good. And nutrition is an integral nutrition is needed as an integral part of the intervention of our CKD patients. Are there any guidelines for nutrition and kidney disease? The question is yes, and it is just this guideline just published this month in the American Journal of Kidney Disease on the 1st of September, and the first author was the co-chair was Alp, and he shared me this data in a meeting last year, and the, he present this data that it is nutrition is a complex condition. A lot of issues are entering in this this scope, and there was an old guidelines that published in 2000 in the American Journal of Kidney Disease, but unfortunately we are not involved in this cohort, neither in the old one nor in the new one. And the Mediterranean region and Africa are not representative, in spite we have a very peculiar dietary regimen that differ a lot from even the Mediterranean diet. And not only that, among the same nation in Egypt, there are great difference between those who are eating in Matruh and Siwa, from those who are the farmer, from those living in the urban region. So we have to be involved in such trials. This is the introduction, and he put the difference between the old guidelines and the recent one. He depends, or the group, the working group, depends on literature during all this period up to 2016, and they involve all these topics. Up to the AKI, it's a very nice review. The major categories of outcome involved in this, in the new one, is the electrolyte biomarkers, the micronutrients, the CKD progression, the comorbidity outcome, and others. The difference between these guidelines and the old one, it was in the assessment, in the intervention, as well as the involvement of the electrolytes and the micronutrients. I will revise it rapidly in these remaining six minutes. In the assessment, there are involvement of the composite nutrition assessment scores, the anthropometric and other measures to assess the body composition, and the technical devices to assess the body composition. This was a recommendation. خلينا ندخل في الصوجم عشان نلحق الوقت بتاعنا. As regards the intervention recommendation, they involve the medical nutrition therapy, and they consider it as a medical therapy, so as to differ to isolate it from the bariatric surgery and all other these. As regards the protein requirement and the energy requirement, they are talking also about the protein energy supplements, the oral, the dialysate, the intran, parenteral, all these. And this is, these are the difference. أنا هاجي بس على الصوجم. This is for the protein. In all category, in peritoneal, in transplant, in pre-dialysis. And this is for the L-carnitine. And this is for the vitamins and the calcium and the sodium. Here they recommend for the sodium intake and blood pressure just in this in adult to CKD 3 to 5, also less than 2.3 grams per day. And also in for the proteinuria, they advocate also the same amount of sodium in those patients. And this is for the potassium, it's not our goal, and the folic acid and supplement, and vitamins, fat soluble and water soluble. So again, this diet, we have to come to conclusion that diet is the central and part of integral approach for our CKD patients. And we have to conclude that DASH is tested to stop only hypertension. It needs more and more trial to test it in CKD. And in our region, we should be involved in such trial because of the special style of dietary strategy among our patients. And nutrition in CKD need not only a nutritionist, not only a nephrologist, but it needs a multifactorial team. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Hala, for this nice talk. Any questions? No questions?
Thank you very much, Professor Hala Wakil, and again, congratulations for being the head of nephrology department at Alex University. I agree totally with DASH diet, and I am fond of potassium. Potassium is the physiological antidote of sodium. This is why we should change our mind as nephrologists to encourage potassium in the early beginning of CKD, and to monitor hyperkalemia in patients with advanced CKD and patients on drugs that can increase potassium. To the extent that in August 31st, there is a very nice meta-analysis published about the primary prevention of CKD. One of the important components of this strategy is to encourage potassium for primary prevention of CKD and for retarding progression of CKD. So potassium is one of the core points. DASH diet includes 9 points. One of them is potassium. So to reduce a little bit sodium, to encourage potassium, this is the best within the core of DASH diet, improving blood pressure and improving CKD progression, retarding progression of CKD.
Thank you, Professor Hala, very nice presentation. And what I got from the presentation that I think we have to adopt and recruit a renal dietitian in each unit or in each nephrology clinic to work with the team. So the presence of a dietitian specialized in nephrology field for patient CKD pre-dialysis or dialysis patient, I think it will be a very important step to improve the quality of life.
Yes, الحياة هو الحياة هو مشروع يعني going on في طب اسكندرية هو establishment of a renal nutrition unit with a professional diploma for the, for renal nutrition. احنا ده in cooperation مع ليليانا جارنياتا in Romania. She is one of the working group in of diet and nutrition in EDITA. And ان شاء الله المره الجايه ان يبقى في عندنا اخبار كويسه ان يبقى في incorporation of such team and such clinics and such diploma for our ستاف ورأي المرة الجاية بإذن الله إن شاء الله وعليكم خير.
Thank you, Dr. Hale.
Thank you.